Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, for the first session of this two-day national conference. I'd like to invite all the speakers for the session to please join us on the dais.
Gasifiers to provide thermal energy in 15 applications. These gasifiers have reduced the energy bills of these enterprises and also provide a cleaner work environment to their workers. We have provided green building advisory to nearly 200 buildings in India, helping them to reduce their energy and water consumption. Our rating system agrees that measures the energy and environmental performance of buildings over the past cycle.
At this point, we're actually running ahead of schedule, so this is good. We will hopefully continue with this for the next 2 days. The objective of this session is to understand the extent to which the 2013 Land Acquisition Act has facilitated the availability of land for industrial and infrastructural projects and the implications of state amendment acts on this purpose. The keynote address for the session will be delivered by Dr. Nirmala Buch. She is a former secretary in the Ministry of Rural Development and was an officer of the Indian Administrative Service. She's held several key policy-making positions in the government of Madhya Pradesh as well as the government of India. She's also been involved with the Mahila Chetna Manch, which is an organization that has done pioneering work in the field of women's rights in the country. I now invite Dr. Buch to please deliver the keynote address.
Friends, let me to begin with thank the organizers, Terry, to give me an opportunity to come. Share some of my experiences, but more than that, learn from what you people have been doing. I will also take you really to from the land of think tanks to where the action is, because I believe and I live in the peripheries areas where action is to be taken and where the problems come, and not think tanks who generally don't interact with those who are party to the whole thing. As we see the LARR Act, it made a very paradigm shift in the whole issue of acquiring land. Land in India is not only an economic asset, it also has sentimental value. Those who are dependent on it are dependent not only for economic reasons, but also because that's all they know, that's all what they have, and they have no opportunity to move away from them. If we really had options, I think they would have also taken a good price for it and left, but that's not a very easy thing to do. Mr. Saxena made my work easier because lots of issues he has raised. Because in the Act, as well as in its implementation, and the changes which the state government have done, and some of the things which they have done, they are the ones which are creating problems. And that he has raised because it's a matter of detail, not only so much as to what the Act says. He was also kind enough to bring in what was the intent in Delhi. It did appear that the law was being made more complicated than simpler. But that's how we all work. By and large, we see a problem and we find solutions which are more complicated than the problem itself. And that's what's happened in this Act, because there are problems, but it is not difficult to solve, provided we have the intention to do and we have all the knowledge. Quite often, when we talk of land, we think certain lands are available. Ms. Saxena gave some of the information. That land is not available just like that. It is my contention, and I think you can find out on the fields. if there is land which is cultivable, it is being cultivated. You may see it is government land, you may say it is forest land, it is maybe private land. It is being cultivated by someone. It is not available just like that, unless it is non-cultivable. Even there sometimes people try to cultivate it because that is where they live, that's all they know about it. So when the question came about land acquisition, and they are all about for industry, for urbanization and all that, then the question comes, how do we acquire? It's a in the 2013 Act, it's a complete paradigm shift as to how you look at land acquisition. Earlier it was a one-sided affair, the state wanted, the state took it, and the cultivator has to accept and all that. Along with all the problems of how harassed he felt, how when he got compensation, the size of compensation, the manner of it, and so on and so forth, we have seen, for instance, in Narmada, tremendous problems as far as land acquisition is concerned. And it was not something which could not have been handled, but a lot of problems were there with some of the interstate projects and all that. Now the land is to be acquired and then the LAR Act comes into applicable. The good things in this is that it creates a role for the stakeholders, namely the farmers, to know what it is, to know about it, to participate in the exercise, and hopefully to get a good compensation. Having said it, then there are problems about what needs to be done subsequently. The key factors in this law are the social impact assessment and the public hearing, which gives to the dialogue and knowledge and information to the farmers whose lands are going to be acquired. But thereafter, when you do the SIA, when you do the public hearing, a lot of problems come because the handling of that issue is not always very simple, particularly because those who are handling it do not have the approach and empathy with the land losers. I'm saying it with all authority because what I see in the land of action, I find a lot of problems. First of all, the SIA report gives a finding about what is the public purpose. Okay, that was already the issue, but there was complications. Then they also are supposed to show that the least displacing option, whether the potential benefits outweigh the social cost and adverse social impacts. And basically, it also includes that participation of the land losers. The focus has shifted to rehabilitation and resettlement, and it includes solatium and higher compensation to ensure substantial life sustenance, livelihood, etc., etc. There are also inclusion of notices of public hearing and so on and so forth. But having done that, when we find on the field that when SIA is done, there are organizations which do with all the empathy, and there are organizations which do not have, we are basically consultants, not knowing what the area is, not knowing the subject, and they have to produce and give what you want. That's not how SIA can be done very well. So even in SIA, there is need of having institutions to know what are the purpose, how it should be done, and how they have to also know the area where they are doing and the population for which it is being done. That is missing quite often. I talked to some of the officers who have been handling the subject. Generally, you find there are two types of officers, those who think that it is unnecessary encumbrance, unnecessary work, it delays. But there are others who have found that there are value in it. And they have found value in the whole issue of conversation, dialogue, which is inherent in SIA and the subsequent public hearing. Some of them have told me that when they had this talk, then they found that the farmers became their partners, really, because they were able to go to them with persons who understood what it was whole purpose was, and they were able to really talk on an equal basis. The others who do not want that, they feel that it is an encumbering process and it should delay. It does take delay if you don't work it properly. I'm also seeing that lot of number of players in this who are in urbanization, all that, are also finding ways of seeing that the farmer doesn't get compensation, or the landowner doesn't get compensation. I'll give you illustrations of that. However, before that, it is also possible that if you follow the intent of the law, which is to make the farmers land losers participants and also talk to them, and then also see that you also go into the least cost options, etc., etc., you can really do something which is in their interest. Let me give you an illustration that if the spirit is imbibed by the officers and others, it can make a difference. We had heard some time ago, I'm talking about Madhya Pradesh, that there is a project in which around Bhopal, 28 villages will be submerged. It was very valuable land because if it is very near the urban areas, it has more value than land which is in the far away. So they said that hum log to bilkul doob jayenge. So we found out as to what was the position, and we found that the situation was really at the DPR stage. Some of us took up the issue and found that it was possible to have a different option, namely that you don't have to have a big dam, you could have barrages. The DPR was changed, and now they are going to have barrages, riverbed barrages, and not dam. Therefore, land is being not being lost. Now, it is possible that if in the spirit of the law is understood, and you work accordingly, then, and if those who are working with government from outside do not have their own agenda of making a big statement and so on and so forth, what Mr. Saxena said about the civil society groups, then I think you can really go through it and see that things can happen differently. Same thing can happen in the case of urban development. Let me give an opposite example, why the spirit of this law is not always accepted. We are having a situation for instance, in Madhya Pradesh, where in urban areas, in the planning areas, a decision has been taken some time ago that if you acquire anyone's property in the planning area, it can have land, it can have structures also, then instead of the compensation, cash compensation, they will give them what is called TDRs, transferable development rights, which means you can have more FAR, etc., etc. Now, what is being done as against having cash compensation, whether it is fair or less fair or more fair or good, etc., etc., you will give a piece of paper. Some of us feel that piece of paper is not going to be very useful for different reasons. It has to have a market. Market will be where you have a very good industrialization. If you don't have that and don't have that market for it, the piece of paper will be no use, because it also says that person has to sell within say, I think 5 years, maybe extended for some time. At the end of it, it becomes of no value. I recollect then when the land reforms took place in 1950s, states made the laws, and then they had what they called Jamidari abolition. The ex-proprietors were given the bonds for 15 years or something like that, because and they sold it for 15-20%, got out of it because they were not going to wait for 15 years. But there the document was valid even after 15 years. There were a capital value of it. In this case, what they call TDRs, it will have no value if you cannot sell up for 5 years. It is my contention, in areas where you could do the same thing without taking permission, you can make construct a house, you construct a floor, you can have what are called illegal avenged colonies without permission. Why will I buy a TDR? So it goes against the provisions of LARR, which is not being made applicable there, and the person will get nothing out of it. So this only shows a conflict between those who think of the land losers as well as of those who are wanting to do development, and they look at both sides. In this case, you are only interested that you want to save money. It's not that you want to faster, and therefore you will not give them compensation, you give a piece of paper. That's the type of speech which if there are the provisions and the intent of this act and similar acts will not be achieved. So therefore, it is my suggestion that what needs to be done is that all those, first of all, I agree with what Mr. Saxena said, in any project, barring some like mining and roads, etc., land is not a very major part of the cost of any industry or any project. It is a very small part. What is important is the time taken and the how fast you can give it to so that they can start the work. That is where the crux lies, which needs to be done, which present act does not provide very much. Because there are a lot of time. So that has to be addressed. Secondly, once the lenders take it, then they can do the work subsequently later on. So if the people follow this intent, then no law, whether it is by amendment to the LAR or otherwise, should be permissible if they are not fair to any land users. Because that always gives a discontent. And it is my belief, and some of my colleagues also agree with it, if you have satisfied losers, they will know how much money they can get and they can do something alternative. And there are alternatives possible in which they can also be stakeholders. A company can also give them a stock in addition to whatever they are giving. Mr. Saxena said very well, 20% FDS. There are ways of giving them the return and the enhanced value. It's true that if a farmer's land is taken today and he finds that the value has gone 100 times, which would not have done if he had who held the land. He feels that he's been cheated. He should have had share in it. So there can be ways of farmers getting share in the increased price of his asset which he has given in the land acquisition. That should be possible. Secondly, after there is a role of not only the officials but also of the civil society groups. Civil society groups very good work when they give information to the people who are going to be affected that what are their rights, etc., etc. But they should also be positive as to getting involved and just say that what can be done. Quite often they say, "Hamara kaam to ye nahi, hamara kaam to aapko batana hai, baaki aap juro." Wo ye nahi ho sakta, lekin kya ho sakta hai aap bhi batayenge. They have to be a positive partner in the process if they want to work on the side of the land losers. It should not be only my role is only this, my role is only this. So there should be the whole spirit of the LARR Act is participation, consent, and discussion. If that spirit is imbibed, then a lot of things can be done without any problem. I know Mr. Saxena mentioned about the tribal areas. In the tribal areas, also, you can do it if you want to do. He also mentioned about a lot of things, but some of the states have done some good work also. For instance, he said about the Women's Rights Act. The women have been given co-partnery, this thing in the Hindu sect, because a lot of that is covered not by the Indian succession, but more by the laws applicable to the Hindu succession, etc., in which they have been given the right to be equal partners, including being co-partners, as they call it Hindu law. But the problem comes that it remains on paper, because there is no social security. So if they take the share, where will they go? Since you raised the question of women, I raise it here because so that we can discuss in this session that women were made equal partners, but no one wants to give. All laws which are to help the vulnerable groups create problems as far as response is concerned. Applies to everything, including the Hindu Succession Act implication. For instance, states came to the ministry saying that we don't want to give this thing to the girls. We don't want to give, which was also not accepted, but it remains on paper. In Madhya Pradesh, they did go ahead and said that no, women will have the rights and they should get it. So when their policy was enunciated, they said we found that though rights were there, but whenever a father died or something, in the succession, the girls' names were not entered because they said, humko nahi chahiye. So they got a piece of paper and they did not get. We suggested that don't do it if the, you put the names. If she wants to give, she can give later. Now, panchayats were, again, you know, issue of different institutions which are involved. They were given the powers to give this documentation. They said, hum jhagde mein nahi padte, hum na kanun ke khilaaf kaam karenge, na hum ladkiyon ko denge. They worked out. Now, what happened that when they started entering the names, but thereafter, they started giving in by registry that we don't want our brothers to have, because there is no social security. Something happens, what will they do? So the whole issue of land is also governed. What is the state of power relations, family structures, how people sort of have social security, and therefore they will not get the benefit which the law provides if we do not work consistently to make them aware as to what this is and also give them viable options to go about it. I also feel that there are those who are not very keen about this law and its implementation. They feel that they have to have what is called efficiency in time limits, etc., etc. They have to do the land acquisition and they should go ahead with it. But I think there should be a distinction between clinical efficiency and effective lasting development, which is important. If you have the farmers and land losers as a partners, then there will be better and lasting impact than where you go very fast and then say you have delivered the goods and you have taken the land and the things don't work well. They have, if the those who are on the side of clinical efficiency, whether they're doing urban development or industrialization, if they also see that there are people on the other side and they take it, including women, which I'll consider later, then I think it'll be a sustainable development, sustainable urban development, and not only something which has happened today. Unfortunately, today, those who are implementing various things, there is emphasis on being number one, being the best, being the top, but what happens beyond that, the quality, etc., is quite often not taken care of the same way. So the likely vulnerable group should be looked at in the whole process, and they should be aware of what the state has given, and the state, the personnel, and civil society groups have to work together so that the act succeeds in intention. But at the same time, I think there is a need to look at some of the details to make them faster, and also to not to have this feeling that this has been made, as Mr. Saxena said, to see that land acquisition does not mean. Land acquisition will be there, but it should be there, we should be fair, faster, speedier, and be understood by all sides so that you can have development as well as the issue of fairness and justice on the part of those who are the farmers and land losers. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your perspectives and also outlining the gaps between the act on paper and in practice. So we'll now continue with the panel discussion. The discussion will be moderated by Mr. H S Meena, who's currently Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Rural Development. And the speakers for the session are Mr. Anil Gupta, Executive Director, Land Management, Airports Authority of India; Dr. Mahesh Kumar of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry; and Mr. Ravindra Shrivastava, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court. I would now like to invite Mr. Meena to please begin the session.
Respected Sri N.C. Saxena Sahab, former Secretary of Rural Development; respected Nirmala Ma'am, former Secretary Ministry of Rural Development; Sri Anil Ji, Mahesh Ji, and other respected participants. It's a very important and very relevant topic for the development of the country. Let me give the background of this act and the present scenario in the country. I have been continuously working on this subject since last, I think, more than 22 years. I joined service when Sri N.C. Saxena was director in the academy. So he has been my guru, he has been my trainer also. So at the outset, I may be excused because there are certain views which may be or might be contrary to the views extended by Mr. N.C. Saxena, because I have slightly different opinion about this act. As a collector for 9 years in 7 districts, I implemented this act and the previous act, the provision, the thought processes of this act and the previous act, 1894. And as a secretary and principal secretary of the Department of Government of Bihar from 2011 to 2014-15, I made certain policies of this act when this was implemented. And from 2015 to till today, I'm struggling as a joint secretary dealing with the Land Acquisition Act in the Government of India. So this is a small background. Now, let me raise certain issues to trigger the discussion of this subject. You may be knowing that land acquisition comes under the concurrent list, serial number 42 of the concurrent list, meaning thereby the central government and the state governments, legislatures are competent to frame the rules and act. Okay. Now the land acquisition process comes under the serial number 18 and 45 of the state list. Thereby, central government cannot make any rule, policy or act. And the act is implemented by the field functionaries, that is the collector and commissioners. So three organs. The field functionaries, the state authorities, that are secretary, principal secretary, directors, and the central government. Unless until they work in close coordination, it will be next to impossible to implement this act. Why? Because this act primarily has certain differences or certain deviations from the earlier act. Earlier act, you may be aware that it's a colonial act, so it was government centric. In simple one sentence, you give me your land and you get away. Whatever I'm offering, you have to accept it. You have got no right to differ from the government decision. This was the earlier act, 1894. Now with the present act, there are three layers of public grievances address system, judicial system. That's the administrated at the project level, the rehabilitation resettlement commissioner at the higher than the district level, that is usually a divisional commissioner or equivalent officer, and the authority who is headed by a single equivalent to the district judge. So these are the three layers of the public grievances redressal system. Now the question whether we should have such a long drawn structure for the public redressal grievances for the land acquisition process, because they are both. It may delay the process of land acquisition, thereby delaying the whole development process in the country. Or on the other hand, it may reduce or it may give a platform to the farmers, to the aggrieved person to redress their grievances, thereby reducing the litigation cost and the cost overrun and time overrun of the project. So you can discuss, you can debate on both sides. I will give you the brief overview of the or status of this acquisition of the land acquisition for the projects using the current act. That's, you will be very optimistic after that. I was also slightly depressing and feeling very negative about this act when I joined as a joint secretary of this department. But after collecting data from the field, it is very exciting. I can give you the, I have collected data 2 months back. For the 6 month, the amount or the quantity or the extent of the land acquired using this act and the similar period, the land acquisition for the similar period using the previous act. And I will tell you, this is 4 to 5 times of the extent of land which has been acquired using this act than the previous act. So it's not that this act is a difficult, complex, and delaying the land acquisition process for the development projects. That's the one thing. Second, that this act has certain different features than the earlier act. First, it's a consultative. It's a democratic. It's a transparent. It has got the mechanism to fix the accountability. Accountability to the extent that if officers, there's any lapses on the part of officers, they may be prosecuted ad mentem in the section under section 85 to 90 of this act, starting from lowest functionary to the highest functionary. Functionary means secretary, patwari to the secretary. So that's the accountability fixability. So it's again big question whether the omission and the commission which are being committed by the patwari or the collector or tehsildar, should the secretary be punished? Now, you see, if I have calculated, we have calculated the time period. There's a table, actually, we have prescribed the table. These are available on the website also, website of the department. If you allow the maximum permissible time, then total time which is required to acquire using the normal process is 59 months of any land acquisition project. There are certain assumptions that project is very large, involving huge displacement of population, and rehabilitation resettlement packages, and providing and making provisions for land for land. So if you take all these parameters, then the maximum time period which is required to acquire a land for any project means power project, irrigation project, any project, is 59 months. That's the maximum permissible. If we take the optimistic period, optimistic means what is the practical? We collected figures from the field. So the average time which has been taken by the state governments and the central agencies are 18 to 20 months in most of the cases. And if you collect the time period, average time period of using the land acquisition process of the previous, using the provision of the previous act, the average time period was 24 to 27 months. These are the figures which are available with the state government, available in the departments also, So it is not that this act is very difficult. Although there are certain complexities, there are certain omissions, there are certain difficulties in implementing of this act. But now, spending 3.5 years, I think out of 3.5 years, I spent 2 years in the Department of Legal Affairs consulting about the provision of this act. Even you might have heard that there's a difference of opinion in the Honorable Supreme Court. You might have heard that Pune Municipal Corporation, the interpretation of 24-2, the excluding of the stay period from the counting of the 5 years from starting from 1-1-2014 to previous, the 5 years prior to that. The interpretation of 24-2, the three judges' benches in the Supreme Court, they have different opinions. So it's slightly difficult for a common man, for a ordinary officers who is working in the field or who is working at the state level to interpret such difficult actually sections. Because in the municipal corporations, the Honorable Supreme Court, three judges bench of the Honorable Supreme Court says that the period should be counted, that it includes in the 5 years. Whereas in the Indore Development Authority, in that case, the Honorable Supreme Court, three judges bench again, they stated that since the person has gone for his own benefit, so the stay period should be excluded from the 5 years. If it is so, then it solves most of the approval laws. Because so far we have received 7 amendments from the 7 states. And I will tell you that none of the states, they have come for the amendment for the provisions other than 24-2 and the monetization of the rehabilitation resettlement packages. These are the 2 areas where most of the states are feeling that they have difficulties in implementation. Otherwise, other places, as far as time constraints are concerned, they don't have any problems. Out of 7 states, I think 5 states, they have come for the amendment of the 24-2. So what does it indicate? If you are coming for the amendment of 24-2, then meaning it means that the administrative machinery in the country have grossly misused their power. Means you have not completed the land acquisition process, especially the award and the payment of the compensation to the farmers, even during the 5 years. 5 years period have been given in the act before implementation of this provision of this act. So if you have not completed the land acquisition process, including preparing of the award and paying the compensation to the farmers for 5 years, then you can very well appreciate the fate of the farmers and their families. Suppose we have been told by the state government, by the respective government or by the respective authority that you work and you will not be paid salary for 5 years. What will happen to our family and our dependent if that is the case? It's similar to the case for the farmer. The compensation, the production, the productivity in the field, the agriculture field, is the salary for him. So that has been experienced in the field. It is in the file that even most of the cases, we have collected the cases where actually my compensation and rehabilitation, resettlement packages have been not provided in the past case using the previous act, 1894, because there was no compulsion. In the present act, if you see the section 38, without providing the rehabilitation, resettlement, development scheme plan to the project-affected families, and they accept it in writing, you cannot displace them. So that's why that so stringent provision has been provided in the act. Because in the previous act, we have collected data also, because there's a, under section 48, there's a national monitoring committee also, headed by the secretary and member secretary, the JS. So we have collected the data also in the previous act, and you would be shocked to know that out of the total displaced families, about 85% of the project affected families were not rehabilitated. And out of 85, about 96% are tribal. So this is the scenario. So whether now the question, the major question arises, whether we should have so comprehensive and so detailed act, or we should go for a legislation which is very simple and similar to the earlier one. So this is a major question. I think now this act, because of the certain problems in the implementation of the previous act, especially for the welfare of the rehabilitation and resettlement of the farmers, even this act has gone to the extent. I have not seen, even I have enacted about 11 acts in the state government, but I have not seen a single act where in the provision of the act any circular of the ministry has been referred. If you see that to the definition part of this act, the section 2, there is a reference of the circular that these are the public purposes, where the actual one circular from the Department of Income Affairs have been referred. So actually the framer of this document, the framer of this act, they have tried, to my understanding, they have tried, it transpired from the files also, that they have tried to articulate or to mention everything clearly and curtail subjectivity of the bureaucrats in the field who are primarily responsible for implementation of this act. So that is my, now there's another problem actually, some of the participants I have already interacted, because sometime I come for deliver of lecture for the trainers. So now there's another problem that part of the provisions of this act, schedule 1, 2, 3, have been made applicable to the central act which are mentioned in the schedule 4, that is 13 acts. Now the major question arises that in the schedule 1, 2, 3, there are certain provisions which are to be notified by the appropriate government, or which have to be explained by the appropriate government. But since you are acquiring land using your own acts, like NH Act, CB Act, Coal Bearing Act, etc. So now, who will be the appropriate government? Whether the appropriate government, as mentioned in your act, which is primarily responsible for the Land Acquisition Act, or the appropriate government, which is mentioned in the Schedule 1, 2, 3. There are certain issues, actually, which have been primarily now addressed, and they have been given to the ministries. And now, I don't think, actually, even we are provoking the state governments, if we find any difficulty, kindly come for the amendments and come for the suggestion. We'll allow those and we'll implement those suggestions. But now, more or less, most of the state governments, they are comfortable, they have settled down. I think most of the doubts, they have been clarified, and now the process, land acquisition process, has picked up. And I will try that after even end of this financial, end of this calendar year, I will try to collect the data and then verify through the use of those data. So now the major questions, that most of the states, they have framed the rules. For UTs, we have framed the rules. They are working well. As I have experienced that most of the institutions who are primarily responsible for the implementation of either this act or the Schedule 1, 2, 3 in case of central ministries, there's a lack of capacity building because this act is not as simple as the previous one. So it requires a lot of capacity building, especially for the frontline functionaries of the officers who are primarily responsible for the preparing of the award, payment of the compensation, and acquiring of the land. Because there are certain issues which are to be very clear before actually we start the land acquisition process. Earlier, actually, the project-affected families were especially defined whoever is the loser of the land. Now, actually, you know that the project-affected family, there are three categories, that the land losers, the agriculture labor, and the service providers. That's a carpenter, blacksmith. So it's very difficult to even identify the particular labor who has been primarily working on a particular field which is subject to acquisition and earning his livelihoods. So these are the issues, actually, unless until you do the comprehensive and intensive capacity building of your officers in the field, it would be highly difficult to understand or comprehend the various provisions of this act and implement those act in the field. Because if you misinterpret any of the act, unless until you are very clear in your mind about the implication of each section, each schedule, it will be difficult for the field officers, especially field officers, because they don't have very strong backup at their end in the office. I know because I have implemented this act as a collector. So will be difficult to implement various provisions. Otherwise, if you understand the provision of this act, I think it will be exaggeration, but it is a fact that it is much, much simpler and enabler than the previous act. Because in the previous act, there were a lot of subjectivity, lot of number of litigations in the courts. Now, after you address, because you might be knowing that civil courts are barred from entertaining of any litigation, only High Court and Supreme Court. So now the litigation cost and time will be very less if you implement in true spirit. And it will be very supporting and very guiding factor for the officer, because everything has been listed in the act. There's nothing which is subjective, or there's nothing left which has got subjectivity at the part of implementing officer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to invite Mr. Anil Gupta to now share his thoughts with us.
Namaskar. Respected Saxena sir, other senior colleagues and my colleagues on the dais, I come from the Airports Authority of India. So I'll try to give you a brief upon to the what we are doing into the aviation sector and how this provisions of the new acts for the land acquisition are impacting the whole aviation sector. It's not only from the per se, from the perspective of the Airport Authority of India, because airports are now being developed not only by the Airport Authority of India, states are also coming forward to develop the airports. And this subject for the land acquisition, it is not only from the, all the eminent speakers have mentioned, it is onto the concurrent list. So even if the airports have to be developed. It's like a project which has to be developed. The states have to come forward to provide the land. Airport Authority of India, as you may be aware, is a statutory authority created by the Act of the Parliament. We per se don't acquire the land for ourselves to for the developing the airports. The land which was under the holding of the central government or the state governments or with the DGC at that point of time was transferred to the Airport Authority of India. And whatever is the land which is required for the further future developments, that is only acquired by the state governments and passed on to the Airports Authority of India on free of cost basis. This is what the understanding has been in the past, that we normally take the land from the state governments on to the free of cost basis. I understand that the basic idea of doing it was that the projects for the aviation airport development itself are very capital intensive projects, like a power plant also. And these aviation projects, airport projects have to be taken as a more of an as economic drivers. So the states were very willing to come forth for the providing the land to the Airports Authority of India, and they have historically provided the land also. So earlier, we have not faced the issue, so much of the issues in acquiring the land or those issues. As of now, Airport Authority of India has about 56,000 acres of the land in total. And probably after the railways and the defense, we may be the third largest owners of the land that way. And most of the land is onto the operational area, about 80% of the land. 10% of the land is onto the terminal side, which we call as the city side, which we are trying to develop for the commercial purposes also, as the railways is trying to do, so as to cross-subsidize the cost of the travel. The basic idea is to make aviation available to all the people, so the cross-subsidy has to happen. But what we are aiming for is that in the next 10 years, the kind of the growth which we have seen in the last 5 years or the 10 years of the aviation, we have grown by about 17% to 18%. You must have seen most of the airports are getting choked, even after a lot of development and investment which has happened at the airport. Let's say in the case of the Delhi also, as of today, we are handling more than 65 million passengers, so which is growing at an about 18%. 18% growth looks good, but it is a difficult growth to manage. If it happens continuously for 4 years, your whole plans goes bust. So now we are coming up with the second airport at the Jewar also. Now, the point I like to bring onto the table is that for a project of a magnitude of a second international airport in one of the cities, the cost of the land acquisition is becoming huge. Probably it is, the reason is those airports, the second airport which we are talking of are in the urban area. That could be one, that is one of the reason. The new act has also played a role into the increase of the cost. As sir was making a mention, the project cost, the land cost in the project should be in the range of about say 5% at maximum. But to give you a brief idea, in case of the Jewar itself project, the land cost is coming around 4,000 crores in the phase one. And the cost of construction would not be more than 5,000 crores. So this is the way the dynamics is. How do you make the project sustainable? Because the ultimate aim is somebody who is putting in the money, either the government or the center, or from the state government or the central government, or a PPP developer. A PPP developer is not going to invest into the money for the land. Then how does the state government gets the money? Does the states have that kind of money to cross-subsidize in the time to come? This is the probably the reason that probably the policy makers would have to give thought onto how do we bring the land, because for the airports to happen, they are the economic powerhouses, I would say. Until unless the land is provided, the airports cannot happen. The technology as of today, we require not less than 1,000 acres of a land to do an airport. We cannot do an airport for 500 acres. Ideally, it should be about 2,000 to 3,000 acres of the land which is required. And everybody wants an airport, say, not more than a half an hour from the place where he stays. So this is the very biggest challenge. Right now we are building up at 5 cities where the second airports are coming, like Delhi, Mumbai, the second airport is coming, Chennai, it is on the threshold, Pune is already there, Calcutta we are looking for, but there is no land. The way the state governments are aligned, it's becoming very, very difficult to acquire the lands. So we had to really give a thought on to how this land acquisition act provisions have to be brought in so that the land is available for the projects to happen. I'll just give you a brief idea what the last budget, the vision that the government of India has taken is to grow by 4x, four times of the present passengers numbers in the next 10 years under the Nav Nirman Yojana. So what we are looking for is 1 billion tickets to be sold in the next 10 years. Ultimately about 2 lakh crore, 2 trillions of the investment that would happen into the aviation sector by the different stakeholders. If the cost of the land itself is going to be out of 40% or 30%, it's not going to be a feasible thing. So I'm just bringing the issues before us. It is not very directly related to the Land Acquisition Act, but definitely it touches upon if the progress has to happen, if the country has to grow at 8%, the aviation per se would grow at 12%. It's 1.5 times multiplier is there. If as GDP is growing at 8%, the aviation will definitely, the passenger numbers would grow at 12%. So to manage 12% growth, it's going to be a challenge for which we had to be prepared and look forward to it. Now I'll just touch base upon to the challenges which we have been facing onto the land acquisition. Is one of the thing that I mentioned about the huge cost which is coming for the land acquisition. My senior colleague just made a mention about the 24-2. It is also impacting us in many of the ways, because at certain places AI has also acquired the land, and what happens is in the development happens at the airport in a phased manner. Like Delhi Airport, we acquired the land in 60s. At that point of time, 5,000 acres land was acquired. That is the reason we are able to expand today. Otherwise, this airport would have been closed 10 years earlier. And we, at that point of time, we have acquired hardly 2,000 or 3,000. We are going to have 4 runways here. And then it will be able to sustain up to 2035. So that is the point, that the 24-2 is also impacting us, because part of the development there is happening post 5 years period also. There is also one under, I think, clause 101 makes a mention it has to happen. Whatever land is acquired, to the development has to happen in the next 5 years' time. 101. So these are the things which are not, probably we would like one exemption from it. I think we are already placed before the committee, which is already for the Second Amendment Act, which is a bill which is all under the discussions, that we should be, as an airport sector aviation, we are part of the infrastructure. If the government decides to keep it away from these stringent provisions, it would be better, because ultimately we had to have a land. And if today we have a land at say 2000 acres at one place, I cannot have land at some other place like a factory or an industry. I had to have a contiguous land. That is a challenge for the airports. So this is one of the point which I thought I'll just make a mention. And the other challenge that we are facing in few of the airports where we have, which were developed in the last 5 years, the rehabilitation and resettlement is becoming an issue, which was done in the earlier act. Now, once what has happened is we provide the requisite money to the state government. We, as per that, we are not, as NHAI is doing, acquiring the land on its own. Airport Authority of India Act doesn't mandates us to acquire the land on our own. So the rehabilitation cost, whatever is we are paying to the state government, it has happened that in the last 5 years, the rehabilitation has not happened. People have not moved into this place. Now with the new act coming into the position, now the cost of the rehabilitation has once again increased by thrice. So that is a very big challenge that we are facing. And this is the reason why we are not able to commit to the state governments also that we would bear the cost. Because the moment we say that we would bear the cost, the R&R cost, what would be the ultimate cost, we are not aware of it. So we try to impress upon the state governments, please provide us the land free of cost, free of all encumbrances. You kindly take care of all the expenditure that would happen. Let us know upfront what is going to be the total expenditure so that we accordingly budget our provisions. With the new act, I think moment we gets onto the more of a maturity level, the acquisition would happen, the R&R things would happen much more quickly, because as Mr. Meena was making a mention, the things are improving. It is a fact that the, once the act is there, maybe we can look for few amendments. It is not the whole color of the act is going to change, because this has come after so much of the consultation happening both at the legislature and at the bureaucratic level. So we'll have to live with it. We'll have to only find some ways how do we mitigate those sort of an issues, which two, three issues which I have made a mention. Rather, I would say there is certain benefits also, I would see, which has happened from this provisions of the new act, that under the emergent clause, we have been able to negotiate certain lands at a very quick way. Maybe at one of the location, we were able to acquire the land in a 6 months' time. Although we paid a higher price, but that was required because there was some vital installation to be done. So we agreed to pay that price, but we were able to acquire the land in 6 months' time, which would have normally taken a 2 years or 3 years' time. So these are the few areas where if the provisions are used in a better way, probably there are advantages also which we can derive from the this whole process. Now, you would appreciate that as the airports develop, there is an all-around economic development happening. So even if, as sir was making a mention, that paying 2 times is also not sufficient many a times, or paying 4 times. What we have thought of is in developing few of the airports now, that we would go for the land pooling policy. So that we make the land owners truly stakeholders, try to bring in their land. Definitely we will give them some employments also and those things, but let them be progressing into a partner into the development also. The way certain state governments allow, the Gujarat government allows that land pooling in a very good way. So we are trying to do in that manner. Maharashtra also allows that land pooling to happen. Few of the state governments, we are doing a study. We are going to go with the, probably we will approach the government of India also, that how do we make the land pooling happen? Because Andhra has done it, tried to do it for the new Bhogapuram airport. Because that is the only way we can bring them together and try to reduce the cost at the initial stage and let them be partner. If airport develops, the economy develops, let they be partner, let they be gaining out of it, the landowners. Because as was mentioned earlier in the day, the land prices would increase by 10 times, even paying 2 times today. We can make the farmers or the landowners agree for a 2 times today and let them be a partner in the whatever is the profit that may happen, accrue to them in a later date. So that is the idea which we are trying to explore. And I hope if our intent is to build 100 more airports in the next 10 years, we will have to look for some innovative solutions. The way the conventional things were happening, this will not happen, because ultimately people would like to be benefited. And as a Government of India organization, our idea is that if there is some development which is happening, it's not only we prosper, it's the whole system, whole economy in and around that area, region or the state prospers. So we are looking onto the land pooling. This is one of the idea. Probably during this discussions in 2 days' time, probably few more ideas would come in, and we would be very receptive. Our team are here. So with these words, I'll close down. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to highlight certain points which you have raised, that this compensation RR policy was there in the department. It was framed in 2007, if you look in the website and other places. But it was a policy. So it was not binding on the state and central ministry, so to say. So you have got the freedom. Either adopt it or adopt your own policies. But we have copied the same provision from that policy. It has been not altered. That 101 he has raised. Of course, there's a provision that within 5 years you should use the land. But what is the definition of use of land or development of the land? It has to be defined in the rules. So you should not be scared. If you see the rules which we have framed for the UTs, it has been mentioned that the department has made a provision of the budget, and it has been provided to the line officers, the officers who are implementing the project,
it is presumed that it has been used for the purpose, it has been, the land has been used for the purpose it has been acquired. So you provide the adequate cushion or leverage in the rules so that there should not be a position where actually you have been asked to return back the land to the farmers. So there is no problem in that. And as far as cost is concerned, of course, there might be some problem because earlier the revision of cost, the circle rate, were not taking place. But now, since the people are aware, the farmer are aware, so they are pressing very hard because in the section, if you see the section 26.5, it says that within 2 months you update the circle rate. You cannot go because recently you might have seen that there's a case of the blood train in the Honorable High Court of the Gujarat, sole on the basis of 26.5, that they have not revised this circle rate since 2011. So our revised rate should be according to the present condition. So now actually everything has been codified, listed in the Act. So only thing that you have not been given that freedom or that leverage that you can go with your own wage. That's the only problem. Thank you very much. He has given many problems, that the cost of the project, 101 problem, then how to fasten the pace of the development by simplifying the land acquisition process. Now I think request.
Thank you, sir. We'd now like to invite Dr. Mahesh Kumar to please share his thoughts.
Good afternoon to dignitaries on the dais and to the esteemed guests of this conference. I am speaking on behalf of FICCI for the implementation concerns of this Act 2013, which have been implementing since 1st January 2014. Earlier Act was almost 119 years old. And it was a colonial act and all those things. But we have to visualize two things now. As per the old act, we could acquire the land in, say, maximum period was 36 to 39 months. As per the new act, we are taking almost 54 to 60 months. In a democracy, we have a government for 60 months. And if we keep acquiring land for 60 months, we all know how things keep changing after every 60 months if the government changes. That perspective also have to be kept in mind. We all agree on one basic premise, that the pace of land acquisition have slowed down. And concerns are expressed by various state governments as well as various departments regarding the new provisions, complexities of the new act, and difficulties being faced because of this new act. We can't overlook all those things. I'll just be flagging few issues which are really hampering the whole system because of this implementation. We all know that the country's economy is bound to get momentum with the passage of time. And how the country will be affected, how the economy will be affected, how the GDP will be affected because of the slow acquisition of the land. This issue is a highly political sensitive issue. The present central government has also been weighing its political options to modify the legislations, and sometimes is allowing the ordinance to lapse. Why so? If we really go to the key words of the Act, take for instance the public purpose. The list is so comprehensive and practically covers all the land acquisition requirements. They talk about the affected family as per Section 3C. That covers even the affected family having land to the decimal places. And because of that, there's a misuse of that. Increasing the people to divide their land artificially into such small pieces and sell them through organized network, and thereby increasing R&R issues. Adversely affected family taken in the act, but still have to be defined appropriately. Scheduled areas, section 3ZD covers that, but it doesn't cover the tribal areas of Northeast region, which is very important for us. Involuntary displacement, again, have been left undefined. Resettlement and rehabilitation, these have been covered in such a way that they are either very lengthy to implement or tedious to implement. I'll tell you how. This act mandates for a social impact assessment prior to initiation of land acquisition. Dear friends, you all know that how the revenue system of the government of the India has been inefficient. No mutations, no transfer of lands on the papers. It's the most rotten organization of the government of India, the revenue department. The senior IAS officer, I may be excused for being slightly harsh. And you want to start the social impact assessment before starting of land acquisition. And the social impact assessment is a necessary pre-notification process before the land acquisition. And in this said process, you have to call all the landowners. And you don't know who the landowners are. Say if you leave some landowners from in between and you carry out the whole process for months and months together, and if few people are left out, then again a cycle of repetition. Now, after that, this results into the repetition of the whole circle. Then estimating the affected families. Difficulty in tribal areas. Friends, do you know that in tribal dominated areas, accurate estimation of lands have not been done since 1912. How would you acquire the land? How would you carry out the social impact assessment? Then consent of land users. That's another a big challenge for everybody. Then they say that social impact management plan. I fail to understand. When we had social impact assessment, was this exercise really necessary for that? You know how many public hearings are taking place? For social impact assessment, we have 2 public hearings, 6 public consultations. These are the mandatory part of EIA, and subsequent to that, the Ministry of Environment and Forest comes over. That is also not sufficient. Then hearings takes place as for the Forest Act. So multiple hearings and hearings and hearings. This is how things are moving. We want to build a highway in 2 years, but we cannot acquire the land in 5 years. What sort of the act is? We want to have the Asian Games construction within 2 years, but we are not able to take decisions of 5 to 6 years. So there's a need of a lot of improvements in this act. Then the creation of SIA units. The creation of SI units have become a challenge substantially. Then there are different yardsticks for SIA. For example, for irrigation projects, there is a complete exemption of social impact assessment, but you will do the environmental impact assessment. Similarly, a copy of social impact assessment report is to be made available to EIA, Environmental Impact Assessment Authority. And since till social impact assessment is not completed, you cannot move to EIA. So it's taking almost double the time. If I visualize for the project concept and site identification for implementation concerns, there are 12 cycles and steps. With the kind of our government working, you can presume how much time it is going to take. Subsequently, if you see the flow chart for diversion of forest land, there are 7 steps. And in between, there are other back references and all those things. So what we need to do is, we need to have a little relook on the whole act. We need to bring out ordinances as fast as possible so that nicely planned, it's a good act. The spirit is good, but implementation methodology needs to be changed. Then there's a problem of multi-crop irrigated land. There are 8 states which have bought all these conditions in a different way. Let's understand and analyze. One senior lawyer friend is here. Why maximum litigations have occurred in past 2 years? Maybe because of Section 24 of the Act. Why we can't bring out quick ordinances for this so as to save the human resource and the hours for save the human hours for that? Similarly, Section 26, market value. You see, there's now what we are looking at is at multiple places, there are inflating market values now. The property dealer mafia has come out with inclusion of highest value sale deeds in a short span of time, thereby nationally inflating the market value for determination of rates and subsequently richer, getting more richer. This is how the things have moved out after this. Then you see how the award is to be prepared. There's a cumbersome procedure for preparing the award. If an individual has to prepare an award, then there are almost 28 steps which has to be filled, even for a bigger landowner and even for a small landowner. So all these things need to have a relook about the same things. There are multiple other issues. Then multiplication factor for the rural areas. Some state is doing 2, another state is doing 1.1, another state is doing 1. Is it fair? 2 states having the same boundary, here you are getting 2. Here you are getting 1. It's highly unfair. Concludingly, I must otherwise say that the efforts and objectives for the enactment of the new Act are well appreciated. However, the implementation of law is more important than the creation of such like legal policies. The concerns raised are genuine and faced by many organizations, and they need to be looked, and appropriate ordinances need to be brought out in the shortest possible time. The policymakers may do well to address these concerns to create a win-win situation for everybody. It would be an earnest wish that this Act becomes a working document that facilitates and contributes to overall socio-economic growth of the country and particularly its subjects. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maheshji. Maheshji has mentioned that largely the present act, the time period of the old act and the new act, the pace of the land acquisition, he has concern, serious concern of the pace of the land acquisition, the SIA, then scheduled areas, then forest, the conversion of the forest land to the, for the non-forest purpose, and the preparation of the award, and section 24(2) and 26. The, especially the inflating the market value in order to get the higher compensation and award. So SI, actually, you may not be aware that the officers who are implementing this act, I also actually, I think as a district collector of the districts, I acquired land for thousands of projects. You tell me the single project in the previous act where you have not conducted SI. Although it was not a part of the act, but it was next to impossible. Unless until you assess the project displaced families, the likely resistance in the field, the structures, the infrastructures, I think no collector will dare to even step in for the land acquisition. But there's a difference. Earlier it was optional. It was at the mercy of officer. He can do at his own leisure. 1 year, 6 months, 8 months, 5 months. Now there is a compulsion that from the date of notification, you have to complete it within the 6 months. So that's the only difference. Otherwise, unless until you conduct SIA, you cannot start any land acquisition process. That's very simple. Section 26, there's a adequate provision, and in the rule, if you see, I have framed rule for Bihar and I have framed rule for the UTs. If you see the definition, I have clearly mentioned that during the SIA, if the middlemen or the mafias, they try to artificially inflate the unit rate of the land in order to defeat the provision of this act, the collector has got right to discard those values. There's a provision in the act. And I mentioned what is the meaning of the inflation rate, that wherever there's a difference of 10% from the average, you should get it inquired into the field, because it happens that since the notification of the SIA to the time actually may you issue the notification on the date which you actually may calculate the market value, there's a approximately 10 to 12 months, 6 plus 2 plus 1 or 15 days or 20 days. So during that period, it is just possible that the mafia, the middlemen, so-called non-farmers, the persons who are actually may not farmer, but they will try to manipulate the things in such a way that they can get out of this process. So during that process, there's a mechanism that collector has been given power to stop the registration. That is one thing. I am always repeating, telling the participant officers in the training courses that kindly you approach to the collector. So collector has got ample power under the Registration Act, which is again administered by our department. Under section 71, he can get it inquired and he can stop registration of a particular area for a time being. So in order to actually avoid those situations, first step that you approach the collector and apprise him about the likely project which is coming in that particular area, and he will issue the instructions, written instructions to the sub-registrar that unless until it is urgent and required in the interest of the farmer, he should not allow the registration of that area. That is one thing. Multiplication factor, again, actually, it depends. Actually, you cannot have a uniform multiplication factor across the country. It has been debated over so many times. You cannot have a multiplication factor same for Delhi and same for UP and same for Rajasthan. Say, for example, Jaisalmer. Because if you see the basic spirit of the multiplication factor is there in order to compensate the difference between the government rate of the registration and the market value of that land. That's the spirit. So thank you very much. I think very good insights, and he has apprised about the difficulties which the industries are facing in acquiring the land acquisition. Now I would request Shrivastava ji to give you about the litigation aspect of this act.
Uh, Good noon, everybody. Madam Nirmala Buch, whom I had the privilege of knowing from my Madhya Pradesh days, as a very distinguished officer who held many responsibilities, including being the Chief Secretary of the State, Mr. Meena, Mr. Gupta, Dr. Mahesh Kumar, Dr. Saxena is not here. Ladies and gentlemen, the organizers, I wish to thank the organizers for organizing this seminar, which is most appropriate. It calls for a review after 5 years of its working. A bigger thank to them for inviting me to be part of this seminar, and I will take this opportunity of placing my views. Organizers have asked me to speak about a limited aspect of the issue, and within a limited time, I will make my effort to do that. And that aspect is concerning the litigation, which either has arisen or is likely to arise because it has the potential to arise in the light of certain state interventions, legislative interventions, in the working of the 2013 Act. As has now been told, 7 states have come forward after the enactment of this 2013 Act to make amendments in the Act in purported exercise of their legislative power. As Mr. Meena has already enlightened that this subject falls in the concurrent list, and the state is claiming that to that extent they have the power to legislate after obtaining the assent of the president. I will address this issue a little later. If the answer is whether these state legislations, which are seen as diluting or tinkering with the 2013 Act's framework, can be challenged or not, my answer is very clear that yes, can be challenged. Perhaps all that you require is to have the resources to engage good lawyers in the courts. And you know from your experience of reading the newspapers and watching the television these days, anything and everything can be brought to the court, it can be challenged. If you want to know what would be the prospect of such a challenge, if your interest is knowing the sustainability of such challenge, I'm sorry, I'm totally helpless. For one reason, all of our students of law, I have been a student of law. I have about 40 years of practice experience also. But still, I cannot say as to what would be the outcome of the challenge, because our experience shows that the courts these days are neither predictable nor are consistent. That's our biggest difficulty. This Act 2013 was implemented on 1st of January 2014. And this is a fantastic act. I'm very thankful to the organizers for giving me a chance to read this act in little detail, because I had an idea about this act, and mainly as Mr. Meena has told that we were doing litigation concerning the interpretation of Section 24, subsection 2 of the Act. But this invitation has given me the opportunity to read the entire Act, not very diligently, but some of the aspects various, of course. And I find that it's a progressive legislation. It is a legislation which was called for with the evolution of the democracy in the country, the economic development, and the prosperity of the people, which is the aim of any welfare government. It has a long title, it has a preamble which speaks everything about the key features of the legislation, 2013 Act, and it's very unique. 1894 Act was a colonial act, and it was enacted in a particular context by the British government to usurp the powers to themselves to consolidate their British rule in this country, and for acquisition of land and there were different times altogether. The landholders were different, there were zamindaris and all kind of things were there. And therefore, as Mr. Meena has very rightly said, that it was very government-centric. It was absolutely one way or a unilateral exercise. All that you needed to do is to issue a notification claiming a particular purpose to be a public purpose, which has, of course, had the semblance of a public purpose, make compliances with the procedure of the Act. Two notifications, Section 4, Section 6 were required. Section 5 of the old Act contemplated inquiry, objection, etc. Many a times they were held, those were gone through, sometimes they were not gone through, invoking the urgency provisions of Section 17 of the old Act. Urgency provision was a very subjective exercise of power, and the matter, then there was an award, position is taken, and the people have been languishing for obtaining the compensation money in spite of the fact that position has been taken. My experience as a lawyer has been that in many of the situations, even the position had been taken, even without initiating the land acquisition proceedings under the statute, that was the kind of the authority which the government exercised. What was happening? The happening was that the entire purpose of the land acquisition was being defeated. It was only giving rise to unrest, dissatisfaction, and there have been very violent agitations also, costing life, costing damage to the property. Mrs. Buch has emphasized, and very rightly, that the key aspect of this Act is to make it a participative exercise and inclusive. After all, what is the problem? The problem is, and that's an ancient problem, we go back to the history of land acquisition and we see that problem. Very commonly, the problem is of economic rights versus property rights. Economic rights are also the rights of the people, but associated with the economic rights is the duty and power of the state for economic purposes, economic development, acquire the land, because that's basic to the development. When that is done under the doctrine, and many of us would know that doctrine is known as eminent domain doctrine in law parlance, which means that the ruler, king, or the crown, or the government of the day has the absolute power to take back the land from the subject. All that it is required to say is that there is a public purpose and that you would be paid compensation for it, of course, fair compensation. So there has been a conflict between the two competing aspects of the same object, namely development, where there is economic rights and the property rights. Of course, the property rights of individuals will have to give way to the economic development, and that had to take precedence. But that would leave a lot of dissatisfaction. People will think that a fair procedure has not been adopted. There has been colorable exercise of power. Some alternative could have been explored. The extent of the land that has been acquired was not really required. And various kind of issues survived. Result was that because of the local unrest and dissatisfaction, there were problems in implementation in various stages of the projects. Now, this Act of 2013, and I must commend those who were involved in the drafting and who gave the thought process to this Act, that they have put in tremendous amount of industry and their experience into it. And it has certain basic features. I would call, like in the constitutional parlance, we have been calling the important, very untouchable features of the Constitution as basic features. But likewise, I also find in the preamble, there are basic features which are fundamental to the scheme and the frame of this Act. And those are that it has to be a consultative exercise, consultative because there are provisions which require consultation with the local bodies. They have a stake. A participative exercise with the land owners and the affected families. The process has to be transparent. It has to be fair, the compensation has to be paid, and there has to be compulsorily rehabilitation and resettlement. The preamble itself states that the cumulative outcome of all these things would be to ultimately produce a project for implementation which has been largely accepted by the people of the local area or the concerned area and can be easily implemented because then they would realize that this is something which is coming up for their own good. Now, this is the basic postulate which flows throughout the fabric of the Act, in various parts of the Act, in various provisions of the Act. The very, as Mr. Meena has said, that the social impact assessment is not something new. He is very right. I have done a lot of cases where the land was acquired for this, go to this spot. Then there would be agitation, there would be hundreds and thousands of people who would be resisting and nothing can be done. So some sort of exercise was already there. As far as the consent is concerned, there was a provision for inviting objections. Objections would be invited and there is a hearing pursuant to those objections. And after all, what was that exercise? The willingness of the landholders and the objection that was there on their part would be examined by the authorities. So some sort of participative process was there. Under this Act, it has now been made mandatory as part of the Act that you have to do it. And why? Because it produces then the result which is desired. With this purpose, there are two provisions, and I'm limiting my address only to those two aspects. That provision was made for obtaining consent in two situations, where the acquisition was sought to be made for public purpose and for the benefit of private-public partnership, a public-private partnership, PPP model, or for the private companies. And the extent of that consent has been defined in the first proviso to section 2, subsection 2, 80% in the first case and the 70% in the second case. Now that, it appears, has been considered as a very serious obstacle by certain segment or the stakeholders in implementation of the Act. The other requirement of a mandatory nature is social impact assessment, determination of social impact assessment, and also determination of public purpose for very elaborate provisions have been made in Part 2 of the Act. Now that was there. In any case, social impact assessment and public purpose, to remove the subjectivity involved in it and to make it an objective exercise, an elaborate provision has been made as to how it would be done. So that's also one of the key features of this Act. The third is in regard to the food security, where there is a multi-crop irrigated land. Then there are very strict conditions with regard to acquisition. Normally it would not be acquired, and if it has to be acquired, then a lot of things have to be done, and only as a last resort. I'm very shocked indeed, to find that within 5 months of the implementation of this Act or the notification of this Act on 1/1/2014, the central government came up with an ordinance. And for what? For doing away of the requirement of obtaining consent for whom? PPP. For private companies. Complete annihilation, complete doing away, total exemption, no consent. So if there is a public-private partnership model, there is some public purpose, then you are not required to take consent of the landowners. It's a total exemption. Similarly, by introducing Section 10A through this ordinance, and that was it remained in the statute for some time till the life of the ordinance. Section 10A was introduced, and that empowered the state government in their discretion to exempt projects which had the public purposes. Why? Namely, so they need not go through the procedure of social impact assessment and determination of public purpose. And also, Chapter 3 provisions, which was for the purposes of ensuring food security, that the land which is irrigated land and is producing multi-crops in a year would not be acquired or would be acquired as a last resort, that's completely done away. I mean, nobody doubts the power of the parliament or the authority of the, or the very limited and rarely exercisable authority of the president or the governor to promulgate an ordinance, which is an executive act. But the question is, what was the background for this? What is the thought? Was 5 months' time enough to give a chance? I don't think the act was even given a fair chance to work it out itself. What was the experience that guided it? I'm absolutely convinced that it was only a demand of certain sector of the people, or it was a very subjective micro point view of the people at some level that they thought, no, this is an hindrance. How can you say that this is an hindrance when you have not given it a chance to work it out itself? You don't have the experience, you don't have the results. And thereafter, repeated promulgations took place to continue this act till the time it became absolutely mandatory, because the matter landed up with the Supreme Court. Some people came to the Supreme Court, they challenged this ordinance making exercise of the central government on various grounds, and the Supreme Court got seized of the matter. Then the bill for amendment was introduced in the Lok Sabha. Well, it suited the majority, and we know how the parliament functions. It passed in the Lok Sabha. I'm not aware how much discussion took place on this subject, but yes, it went through. It came to Rajya Sabha, where it saw a lot of problems and had to be referred ultimately to a joint committee of the parliament. And that is sometime in the 2015 or 16. Having been referred to the joint committee of the parliament, the parliamentary exercise of legislation is still on. It has not ended. The parliament is still in season of the matter as to whether or not Section 10A should be inserted. Section 2.2 should be amended to dispense with the requirement of consent. Section 10A should really be in the present form with total exemption, be there or with some conditions or with some guidelines or not, has still to be examined by the parliament. After the report of the parliamentary committee, it has to come back to the parliament. Now see what happens. When it did not get through in the Rajya Sabha, and the matter is lying with the parliamentary committee, there is a club of states who are advised, and I'm sure they are advised, to adopt a route of exercising their legislative powers of amendment, the matter being in the concurrent list, and taking the assent of the president. And the cat is out of the bag when we see that all these three or four state amendments, Gujarat taking the lead, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh following it, Maharashtra following it, or some other states, they have just copied and pasted the ordinance and the bill that was introduced in the parliament. Section 2.2 is verbatim, without change in comma and full stop. Section 10A is absolutely verbatim. Other provisions with regard to the voluntary acquisition and payment of lump sum amount, even to the extent of 50% of the compensation that is payable, is all verbatim. And the president was pleased to give the assent. We are not aware, and sometimes we can be aware, because everything can come to public domain, as to the, how the assent of the president was sought, what was the level of consideration by the president while giving the assent, and what is the quality and content of the assent given by the president. If an occasion comes, we will do that, and the courts will definitely look into it, because this is nothing today which is the beyond a pale of judicial review, including the power of the president to give assent to an order, to an amendment or to a law, which prima facie on the face of it is repugnant to the parliamentary law. There is no doubt about the repugnancy, but what saves those state amendments is only the assent of the president, and that can be challenged. I see, and I have no views. I mean, I'll make my submission with regard to, or the my points with regard to the legality of these amendments little later, but I'm only on the procedure right now. I see these amendments not only as dilution of the 2013 Act, but as very annihilation of the 2013 Act, the basic features of the 2013 Act. Consent, SIA, public purpose assessment are matters which are directly linked with the transparency requirement of the Act. Inclusivity of the process, participative process. And there is no way you can completely do away with these requirements without disturbing the fabric and the structure of the 2013 Act. It can be moderated to suit the certain circumstances with necessary changes. For example, when I was discussing this issue with my very learned and able colleagues in my office, I thought, why can't it be done that if the time, you are surprised to see only one sentence in the statement of objects and reasons of the bill, that it is to expedite the project execution. As if 2013 Act is a stumbling block. There's a period given for SIA assessment, 6 months under the law, it's a mandate, has to be completed. In a very emergent situation, and I would be very fair and objective, in a project which is of utmost importance in the interests of the nation, such as a defense project or project of national security, you can provide for a shorter time. You can perhaps, in the detailed procedure for SIA, do away with some of the procedures which are non-essentials. Likewise, if there is a requirement of consent, instead of 80% consent being insisted in case of PPP, you can perhaps, in those category of cases, reduce it to 50% or 51%. You may say that, yes, 51% consent is good enough. 70% can always be requested, but you cannot totally do away, because you are then excluding the class, completely excluding the class, the landowners, from the process of acquisition. Don't do that. That will become counterproductive. That will only give rise to resistance. And why do you presume that this procedure of social impact assessment, entrusting or enjoining responsibilities on the officers on the spot, or the machinery on the spot which is to work, if they do their job properly, they will be insensitive? I don't have any reason to think that they would have a closed mind and they would not be insensitive to the issues or the requirements of public interest, national importance, and the welfare of their own self. They can be educated. The village, I mean, we call the rural population, is also very alert. They are very intelligent. They are wiser than us. They can be educated. But on some hypothetical assumption that there would be delay of the project if these procedures are followed, and therefore need not be followed, that's completely wrong, and it should not have been done. So that is my, I see. Now, as far as the challenge is concerned, I mean, I as far as consent is concerned, let me also say that this is with regard to the procedure, because I see that this entire procedure of state legislation is a constitutional fraud. This is done with the tacit support and consent of the central government when the matter is sent to the president for assent and his assent is obtained. I don't know how much disclosure about the repugnancy and its effects have been brought to the notice of the president for enabling him to take a very informed, considered decision whether to give or withhold the consent. That is a matter which will be examined by the court someday, I am very sure. The parliament has been completely bypassed. It's a complete legislative overreach by the state governments. This is about the procedure. However, with regard to the legality and propriety of these provisions are concerned, I do feel that consent provisions need to be reasonable, have to be reasonable. In the name of giving participation to the landholders, you cannot give a tool in their hand which can hold you into complete ransom. If they form a group, either motivated or with some ulterior object, or driven by political considerations, and withhold the consent for reasons which are not just and proper, then again at the same time it would not be in the interest of the people. It would not be in the interest of the development. I am not in favor of giving an absolute power to the people in the name of their consent where this can be misused. I have a suggestion which can possibly be taken note of my very distinguished officer, Mr. Meena, that we have, I recollect from my memory, that there are provisions in the old acts like Telegraph Act and the old Electricity Act, that where the land was required for the purposes of erection of the towers or the poles, etc., and that necessitated acquisition of the private land or use of the private land, the law required that the consent must be taken. We have similar laws in the mining also, laws for taking consent of the landowners before the grant of mining lease or the prospecting license, because ultimately it is their land. But there is nothing like absolute consent. In those cases, there is a provision I recollect that where the consent was withheld for reasons which are not justifiable or which are absolutely untenable, then there was a provision to approach an authority, a judicial authority, for determination of the objections which they had. And why not the same thing can be done, that a similar machinery is created to examine the withholding of the consent by the landowners, by a judicial authority or a quasi-judicial authority, within a limited period of time, and then what he decides is final. This can be done. Super social impact assessment provision also has a very salutary object. It is a very wholesome provision, and a complete annihilation of such a provision in the name of public-private partnership and private companies' interests is absolutely illegal. It violates the basic feature of the 2013 Act. 2013 Act is working well, and I was very delighted to hear it from Mr. Meena, that his experience and his study shows that this work has really done well, and that's a very enlightening information to us. If that is so, all I would wish is that let those who are responsible with the implementation of the Act be more sensitive towards the people who are affected, the landowners, their families, the affected families, and also towards the need of the people or the need of the entities which require the land for development. There has to be a proper balancing of both the rights, undoubtedly, both the aspects. And there are some issues which require ironing out of the creases only in the area of implementation. My learned friend, Mr. Dr. Mahesh Kumar, has been very candid to say that the spirit of the Act is very good, but the problems are only of implementation. And all that I understood from his discourse was that these were all implementation problems, and he had something to say about the bureaucracy. I don't entirely agree with this. We have good officers, not too good officers, bad officers. But yes, we can produce good machinery. It's implement. After all, it lies with the authorities or the superior structure which monitors the implementation. And there is nothing in the Act which can really, if implemented in its right spirit, in accordance with its heart and soul, that it can stand in the way of the development of the country and the progress of the people. Thank you very much. I'm indeed honored to be present here. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you very much, Shrivastava ji, the senior advocate in the Honorable Supreme Court. Now you must be very confused because two panelists spoke about the in support of the Act. One is slightly neutral and one is entirely against. But because of the time constraints, I have forgotten to explain that I had an occasion to present this Act before the international community in ADB Manila, wherein about 192 delegates of the 63 countries were present, and similarly in the World Bank also, Washington. And I must tell you that it is in the record that this document has been classified as one of the best documents in the world as far as livelihood, rehabilitation, resettlement, obligation, compliance are concerned. We are lacking only one compliance. Otherwise, we are 100% compliant of the World Bank and the ADB norms. This is the only document in the world. And I think we are criticizing the document, Act, legislation, wherein Vietnam and other countries, they are following it. They are copying it. We are lacking only in the case of that a person, if he is residing illegally on a government land, then as per the provision of this Act, he is not entitled to any type of compensation. But as per World Bank and ADB, that he should also be given some sort of assurance of or support of the livelihood. So that's the only place where we are lacking, and intensely actually we are, because of the condition in our country, we are not allowing that. That is one thing. Second, that Mahesh ji, Shrivastava ji is very correctly explained the every provision, that it's an implementation issue. I do agree, because I have worked as a principal secretary in the department. I worked as a collector. We are not ready to actually build the capacity of the officers. If you see the section 90, the section 38 and the section 30, it says that the 12% addition is from the date of SIA to the date of taking of possession. Whereas in the section 38, if you say that the 12% is from the date of the notification under section 11.1 to the date of possession. So there are certain, but to my mind, that is also correct, because in certain cases, you don't require SIA. So in that case, the cutting date is line of the time period is the date of notification under section 11.1. So, but Act, actually, per se, there is no problem if you follow all the provisions and if you have a capacity, especially the capacity of the SIA team, SIA experts, the SIA persons, the SIA institutions, then I think it's very simple. Afterwards, it's very simple. If you conduct successfully the SIA and the report is accepted by the government, then subsequently the process becomes very simple. I can give you a very, although it's already late, but I can give you a very simple example. The Honorable present CM was Agriculture and Railway Minister in the Government of India, Nitish Ji. So he has a very dream project, that Navinagar Super Thermal Power Project in joint venture with the NTPC and the government of Bihar. So there actually there was a complete stuck between the farmers were not accepting the it was acquired using the old provision of the old Act. So farmers were not actually ready to accept the compensation, the amount of compensation. And there were firing, 19 persons were died, 2 persons were died, 20-25 cases were lodged against the farmers, against the officers. So all sort of problems. And in spite of acquisition of the land, Chin project could not start. So I joined 2011 as a secretary and principal secretary of the department. So I was given that mandate. So only reason why it was stuck that they have not conducted the SIA. Nobody has gone to the site. In when first I visited in 2011, the village, actually the 8-9 villages where this project was located, about 2,000 families were to be displaced. So they said that even the Patwari did not come to the site. And when collector and myself, we consulted, even within 5 days, actually the project was started. So it is not that the SIA was not there in the earlier project. I can assure, even I can say with the authenticity as experience of land acquisition in the field, that unless if you had not conducted SIA in the old acts, I think no land acquisition could have been succeeded. That's my experience. So it was compulsory in the old act also, although it was not a part of the act. Now, because of the, if you see the policy 2007, it was enacted, formulated before this act. SIA was in the same form as it is in the new act. There's no difference. Even not a difference of a full stop comma. It was already there. Only thing that it was a policy, so it was not binding on the central government and state government. So thank you very much, Mahesh ji. Now I think what is the next program? You have some time to... No, there's no time. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much to all the speakers for taking time out of their schedules to join us today. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions right now. We're running a little behind schedule. But in the next coming sessions, of course, we would like to hear from the audience as well. I'd like to request Dr. Das to give a token of our appreciation to all the speakers for taking time out to join us today.
सब केस होते हैं सिमस कब साफ सारे तेलंगाना हैज बीन स्टक डाउन गुजरात भी चैलेंज किया वो दे आर इन द प्रॉब्लम महाराष्ट्र का भी चैलेंज किया है हरियाणा का भी चैलेंज किया है सारे दे आर इन प्रॉब्लम और हम लोग परेशानी पड़े हुए एक बार कंसेंट तो दे दिया असेंट तो दे दिया प्रेसिडेंट ने बट नाउ
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
So we've been able to hear several different viewpoints, each of which is compelling in its own way. And now I'd like to invite everyone to join us for lunch, which is served outside. And the next session will start at 2:15. Thank you.